Friends, subbers, countrymen, lend me your ears, for I seem to have misplaced mine and I can't hear anything. Welcome to the Civ 5 Battle Royale X Mark 4 Power Rankings Episode 5. We had a great time last week. Lots of fun and bloodshed and embezzlement and things. Alright, let's jump into it with the Power Rankings. In number 61, we have Shawnee.
Okay,
I'm going to say something shocking. I don't think the Shawnee are going to be the first to die. Sure, they're a city-state at this point. Sure, they have garbage stats. Sure, they're pretty boxed in. But let me ask you this. Who's going to kill them? The Osage are weak, the Seneca are capoys, and everyone else is too far away to matter. While they aren't going to leave the bottom 10, they will probably not leave first. At number 60, we have Rosvi. The Rosvi are just waiting for the worms now. Dead bulls withering in the droughts of the Serengeti. No prospects, no stats, no hope. At number 59, we have the Finns. The Finns started this part by being an awful statted runt just north of a surprise success story whose settlements have boxed them the hell in. They also ended the part by continuing to be an awful statted runt just north of a surprise success story whose settlements have boxed them the hell in. Finns suck, man. In 58th, we have the Kalmyks. Kalmyks are really just banished to Georgia, not the state, at this point. They're weaker than all the neighbors and have nowhere to expand into. GG. Next. In 57th, we have Tehuelche.
Hey guys, resident sleeper Tehuelche here. Today I'll be teaching you how to sleep. Just do after me.
The Power Rankers are not responsible for any sleeping-related accidents. In 56th, we have Machnovia. Machno is about to make or break his entire game. After giving away Ekaterinoslav and tanking his chances, everyone thought it was over for our brothers in black. But here they look poised to take that back, and Latvian Rakesne to boot. If they can swing that, they have a solid 5-city core to start building from. If not, that's it. No more chances. Everyone else is about to start solidifying, and Machnovia will be left behind, full of broken dreams and expectations quashed. Everything on black, and let it ride. At number 55, we have the Mamluks.
They built a settler! Mamluks built a settler! And they used it too! Woo!
Hence, we've moved them up 3 whole spots. No reason currently to believe they'll go anywhere regardless of the third city. At number 54, we have Osage. Osage moves up a spot in the rankings this time, but that's mostly just noise with a pinch of shock from them holding back Seneca. Looking past that, you have a civ that only continues to live due to Pueblo taking a bit of time to move their army in, Mexico weighing its best expansion routes, and everyone directly east of them just kind of sucking at life. Yeah, don't expect these guys to be a surprise comeback civ anytime soon. At number 53, we have Rio Grande. Nothing happened in the Rio Grande-Bora Bora War, but Rio Grande did settle a sneaky civ in New Holland's armpit that will surely be lost if those two ever go to war. We've raised them 1 rank for trying. In 52nd, we have Florida.
Hello. Florida still sucks. Nothing's changed.
In 51, we have Kazan. Kazan drops to 51st after losing Elista to Bukhara, relegating them to 2 cities. And as I write that, I found out they settled the 4th city off-screen. No matter, their predicament hasn't changed. They're firmly quashed below a litany of stronger, more militarized foes, taking the dubious honor of worst European civ that's not the Finns. Even their weakest foe in Bukhara has proven capable of manhandling them with ease. No science, no stats, not much space left, and no future. a true disappointment for Mohammadamin, whom we all viewed with high expectations. In 50th place, we have Royal Hungary. As Royal Hungary fails to settle and continues to stagnate their own growth by killing off their citizens, they keep sinking in the rankings. We finally hit the point where their self-sabotage has earned them the spot of worst European, editor's note, Kazan doesn't count, I guess, LMAO, sinking even below the Italian civ that hasn't yet settled a single city on the Italian subcontinent. Honestly, I'm glad the flavor's on point, but as a Royal Hungary supporter, it is sad. At number 49, we have the Taino. Well, it seems that the Caribbean is going to be quickly out of Taino hands. Can't say this is going to go well for them. Maybe they can put those unique great generals to use? No? Definitely not? Ah, well, who could have seen that one coming? And number 48, we have Eswatini. Eswatini and Ndongo might be at war while sharing a border, but don't expect any cities to flip. Sure, Lugano took some damage this episode, but it was fine during the last shot we saw of it. Furthermore, with another settler, Ndluli could even go and settle Madagascar. Doing so will give them an even bigger boost than the ones they got this part. At number 46, we have Rome. It's almost turn 100, and our Italian civ has settled zero cities on the Italian peninsula. That's kind of sad. That's very sad. At least Rome isn't actively killing their own citizens, so they aren't the worst civ in Europe. At number 46, we have Vijayanagara. I will not lie, I copy-pasted Vijayanagara onto this text bubble when mentioning them. In fact, every time I mention Vijayanagara by name, I'll be utilizing the paste button of Command-Shift-V on my laptop. At the end of the day, Vijayanagara is just fundamentally a difficult word to spell, and would have taken me just a slightly larger amount of effort than I usually expend in order to learn how to spell this word. Other than that, Vijayanagara had another unremarkable part, as they realize they are sectioned off from the rest of the world. The curse of the Indian Peninsula. In 45th, we have the Crow. Crow miraculously manages to hold onto its city against the Yelenis, something that a lot of power rankers were not convinced that they could do. They're still in a terrible, terrible spot, but they aren't really on the cusp of death like other North American civs. And that earns them a few spots in the rankings. At number 44, we have Mogadishu. The other shoe has dropped for Mogadishu. For a while now, we were waiting for them to turn into the stats powerhouse that they so often were in the tests, to wake up and settle some new cities, but they just haven't. They still have only 3 cities, which is just not acceptable at this point of the game, and they allowed Saba to take some lands that should have been theirs. Now they're running out of options. It's not over yet for Mogadishu, but boy are they not trying very hard to convince us of that. At number 43, we have Bavaria. Bavaria really did not have a good time this week. They declared war on Royal Hungary, despite having a smaller army, predictably got nowhere, then made peace. They settled the last spot they possibly could and missed out on way more because they dilly-dallied and allowed the Pharaohs to settle Denmark. So now they're boxed in with only 4 cities and nowhere to go. Consensus is, they're fucked. At number 42, we have Seneca. Seneca continues to struggle with the concept of doing things. Or, well, they are over those age, just aren't doing anything there. And now that the Pharaohs are settling the northern coast, Seneca is losing its major advantage so far, lots of land. If they don't move quickly to settle the rest of it, then they're gonna get stuck with a shitty 4-city line that is so easy to invade that they'll be gone before we know it. At number 41, we have Burgundy. The Gundy is starting to look like a victim to classic European overcrowding. They'd be doing fairly well anywhere else, but here? They can't win a war against Bavaria, they can't win a war against the Visigoths, they have absolutely nowhere to go but infinite stalemate unto death. What are they going to do, hop on a Pharaoh conquest of England? Burgundy is down with the rats, and they just don't have enough tails to be king. And number 40, we have Die Viet. Die Viet is still getting left in the dust, more or less. Even Siam has improved pretty nicely now, and Zheng, of course, has been statistically above average for a while now. Singapore's still climbing, and Maguindanao is being aggressive. What claim to fame does Die Viet have? A widespread religion? Well, holy wars are a thing, maybe it'll do something. But come on, there's more to the game than this. At number 39, we have England. Beyond a pale of weathered hopes lay a king of lion's robes. With the sword shifting like Satan's fingers, who hath dedicated himself to linger. But who laid his nation to rest for the sole goal of preventing duress? A curse befall ignoble thee, such that you may never see. But thou shalt grow thy creeping vines, one at a time, slowly through the lines. Victim of ghosts of the mind, Henry the Lionheart, king most kind. At number 38, we have Saba Demit. Saba Demit is having one of the more impressive comebacks for a Part 12 Civ that didn't settle at all. I'm very proud of them. They're still lagging behind in tech, but they've hopped up to 5 cities and an overall decent economy. They don't look fantastic, but they look a hell of a lot better than their closest neighbor, Mogadishu, who is doing absolutely nothing. One of the reasons that Saba was ranked so low in the beginning of the game was due to how we expected Mogadishu to crush them quickly, but I think Saba is quite a powerful civ. So, in a world where Saba is playing the game and Mogadishu is not, I have really high hopes for them. At number 37, we have Sierra Leone. A 23 rank drop seems kinda harsh for a civ who only lost a single city in a single war. However, the PR team thinks it's warranted because the PR team thinks that both Alawites and Kanembornu are much stronger now. But not me. Sierra Leone's still great. Alawites suck. Kanembornu made peace. Everything's gonna be fine. Alawites look scary with their large army and 7 cities, but their non-capital cities are all dogshit desert hellholes that are not going to do anything until their UI is unlocked with chivalry. Sierra Leone's core is just better. And yeah, Kanembornu is better, but their stats are at best mediocre and they just pieced out. Sierra Leone's aren't great either, but they have all the time in the world to rebuild. I'm optimistic. Also, the Alawites suck. In 36th place, we have Mongolia. Well, they actually let Shang have Old Sarai, and notably settled New Sarai to make up for it. Funny as all hell, but letting Shang just have the city is still sad. Mongolia had troops, just not anywhere close to the city. And then they made peace right after Shang flipped the city. Utterly unimpressive. Still, despite it all, their stats are on the rise, thanks to the continued settling in spite of the blunder that was Old Sarai. It's important to keep your morale up even when the going gets rough, after all. At number 35, we have the Visigoths. The Overguild is stuck in the Iberian Peninsula by Burgundy to the north and England's navy off the coast. Thankfully, Amerita is a one-tile port, and they now have their UU, the Gardingo. Hopefully they can use it against Burgundy sometime soon. In 34th, we have Singapore. Singapore has come far from their original 61st rank, but Timor-Leste, they are not. With Mag and Siam in the area, they're more likely to be in Indonesia. I'm not saying they have no chance, just that their chances aren't as good as some others in Southeast Asia. These guys need a navy. At number 33, we have Kanembornu. Wow, who knew they had that dog in them? Kanembornu takes aim and actually takes the shot. Bo was fucking gone. Which is not to say that KB raised the city. They definitely kept it. Sierra Leone has no army left, the Alawites are settling Flat Desert, and Ndongo is focused in the south. Now the problem is that despite this impressive victory, KB fucking sucks. They got nothing going for them. Bottom of the barrel stats. They're gonna have to really get it together and soon, or they'll have no path to world conquest, occasional impressive military victories notwithstanding. In 32nd, we have the Karmatians. Y'all, can you believe this? The Karmatians finally decided to play the game. this part, the Karmatians finally decided to use the army that has frankly been idling by in the middle of the desert, and have actually pushed the Absarids back to Persia with minimal difficulty. They're even settling cities for themselves too, and are beginning to actually look like a threatening early game regional power. Okay, maybe that's going too far, but there is still a lot of room for the Karmatians to continue growing. And while I don't think their advancement into Absarid territory is going to go much further due to defensive terrain, just getting the cities that they did, Bandera, Bashar, and Shiraz, is a great start for them. In 31st, we have the Kossuths. The loss of Gangtse kneecaps Kossuths' northward expansion this part. Now stuck in the mountains, the Kossuths are probably going to end up like Tibet in Mark II. I wonder if we'll see an enclave again. In 30th place, we have Siam. Siam is doing better than expected still. Five cities and two settlers down near Sri Lanka, really capitalizing on Vijayanagara being lazy and Kossuths not settling south. Really what they need right now is not to be attacked or to build up an army or navy and go after someone like Singapore. At number 29, we have Bukhara. Bukhara has a great part as they successfully snatch Elista from Kazan, giving them a nice long corridor of expansion to worm their way out of. While they're still right in between the crossroads of the superpowers of the Afsharids and Kazakhstan, they have proven they're incredibly shifty and more than capable of clawing their way out of the poor starting location. Combined with decent enough production and growth, including development on newer cities, and the Afsharids showing weakness against the Karmatians, the Bukharans get a well-deserved glide up to the top half of the roster. In 28th, we have Zhang. Zhang rises 5 ranks because they settled 2 more cities and are not doing horribly in their war against their top 3 ranked neighbor, Shang. Their settlement in the Philippines is a bold move that might help them cripple Maguindanao now in the future. There's also still room for them to settle another city in the Sichuan area if they're quick about it. At number 27, we have Ecuador. Ecuador suddenly rises 7 places for unclear reasons. As far as I can tell, the power rankers mostly just realize that they exist. New Holland attacked them, which is going nowhere, and they settled 2 more cities, so, you know, I guess they're doing alright. At number 26, we have Maguindanao. Maguindanao snaps up Kuno, unsurprisingly. Despite being a stats monster, Waki left that city completely undefended. Then, Maguindanao looked like they were about to grab a second city, but were eventually rebuffed. This is all quite impressive. However, this part wasn't all good for Maguindanao. Piecing out with Wagi while the giant was still weak was probably not the best move. Wagi picked up Gate of the Sun, an extremely powerful growth wonder, so I expect Mag to be thoroughly outclassed in round 2. Secondly, at the very end of the part, Zhang managed to found a city on the Philippine archipelago. Whether this is a very kind donation or a future invasion standing point remains to be seen, but either way, it would have been better had Maguindanao just managed to settle their own archipelago. In 25th place, we have the Yellowknives. So the Yellowknives forgot how to keep building soldiers, and now the Crow have both completely retaken Bakisi and are shooting at their cities. Now, a few archers peppering some border cities isn't likely to go anywhere on its own, but the fact that things have gotten to this point is just not a good look. They've got the time and the space to fix this in the future, but for now they need to cut their losses and peace out before the Crow somehow actually take a city off their undefended border. In 24th, we have Nivk. Another episode in which Nivk did nothing. So far, I'm not getting the impression that these guys are Chukchi 2.0. In 23rd, we have Ikuiki. Despite refusing to settle Honshu, Ikuiki has managed to get out a fifth city and has pumped out some very respectable stats. Yes, this goofy settling pattern is hurting them and keeping them out of top tier, despite their strong tech and decent production. I worry that the Japanese Isles might get settled by some of their very, very powerful neighbors like Shang or Goguryeo cutting their empire in half. Ico has more than enough time to fix that, but the longer the game goes on, the less and less important these stats look compared to Ikuiki's position on the map. In 22nd, we have Harappa. Harappa may not have taken quite the control of India they could have by this point, but they're certainly still on top of Vijay by miles. The Kossuths are shaping up to be a definite threat, but they don't look like one Harappa can't deal with just yet. Of course, this is all assuming everyone is a perfectly rational actor, which we all know the AI is not. Harappa isn't focused on growing cities, they're not focused on army, they're not settling badly, but they need a little something extra to make it all pop. In 21st, we have Bora Bora. We're Bora Bora-ing into South America with this one, boys. They have a solid land army to keep everything protected, but really, Bora Bora needs more settlers right now. Tepelche ain't settling, so Bora Bora has to get on it now before it's too late. But also has to settle the islands around their start before Waki's settler machine overruns the area. Really, they just need a lot of settlers. And breaking into the top 20, we have Umasami. Well, it wasn't an exciting part for Umasami, but that's okay. They're up and about settling new cities again, a concept that's still kind of alien to the Finns. They're on the up and up in terms of stats, too, which is inspiring a bit of hope. They'll eventually clash with pharaohs, who are essentially a stage hazard at this time, but there's time, and most of Umasami's cities are inland, though they are settling more coastal cities now. At this time, I would predict that the pharaohs slow down at some point, which will be Umasami's golden opportunity. Before then, just expand eastward. Or southward. Latvia is kind of in the way of eastward expansion. In 19th place, we have the Dzungars. The Dzungars punished the Kossuth forward settle by easily picking it off. I will say I think Dzungars are looking like a fairly run-of-the-mill Central Asian civ, but now they have a track record of winning wars, and, unlike Bukhara, have a little more room to found a handful of cities. I see quite a bit of potential in Dzungars, but on the flip side, Dzungars have a lot of scary neighbors, like Salcups and Shang. Things can go either way, but I'm optimistic. In 18th place we have Alawites. Plenty of excitement nearby, but Alawites themselves did nothing much. Sierra Leone's plan to build non-military backfired spectacularly, and Kanembornu jumps into relevancy. Now don't get it twisted, KB still sucks ass, statistically speaking. For Alawites, the situation is ideal. Most of the Alawite Empire is inland, meaning there's little risk of a sudden Visigothic or Roman invasion across the sea. Meanwhile, Sierra Leone is getting smacked around by one of the weakest civs on the continent, who remains weak despite the success. Far to the east, the Mamluks just learn how to build a settler. Alawites are in an ideal situation to build up, or perhaps even take advantage of the weakened state of the two civs to the south, as may turn out to be the case. A sizable Alawite army was seen marching south. Keep an eye on these guys, they may be going places. In 17th place we have Mexico. Mexico, realizing that it's probably not expanding north anytime soon, has said, fuck it, time to go into the Caribbean and is sending a naval force out. Admittedly, this is probably their best choice of action given their circumstances, and there are still chunks in North America available for settlement, along with Cuba and South America to a lesser extent. Even if they don't reach the main continent on time, Osage or Taino should be a relatively easy conquest. Puebla was blocking a straightforward northward expansion, and obviously Mexico can't expand into the Pacific Ocean right now, but they could easily start going full conquest mode around the Caribbean, and the only civ that could really even delay them is maybe New Holland. Still, the path of weak resistance is always worse than the path of no resistance, forcing a lower Mexico this week. But believe me, they're down, but far from out. In number 16, we have Palawa. So, it turns out we might have a good Western Australian civ this game. This is unfortunate news for Palawa. The naval assault on Pinjara is doomed. Even if they flip it, Noongar will just take it back, though the process may at least divert forces from taking Kriwa, the current battle line. Even as much of a waste as that process looks, it's still probably their best hope. They lack the land forces to drag out the assault on Kriwa, so if they intend to hold out, they need to drag the hell out of this naval raid until Lungar comes to the peace table and accepts Uluru a sufficient victory. That's probably not gonna happen, so look forward to seeing Kriwa painted in more striking colors next part. It's not the end of the run for Palawa. Noongar probably won't be able to push any further, and they still have the more productive chunk of Australia. But boy, is it a bad sign to see their neighbor being so actively militaristic when they got so complacent. In 15th place, we have Noongar.
It's high Noongar, bitches.
From Kentore, east to Yuandemu, where the bloodwood and the desert oak steam in 45 degrees, beds are burning as the Noongar plits Palawa's western desert. The time has come for those subtle happy Palawans to pay the rent, it seems. Okay, I can't figure out how to get any more lines from beds are burning into this write-up, so let's drop the act. Noongar made a huge play out of nowhere, seizing the Palawa city and threatening to take more in short order thanks to their overwhelming military superiority. It's uncertain how far exactly they'll go, but what is clear is that the former balance of power in Australia, with Palawa heavily favored, has been irreversibly disrupted. It's no longer clear who will control the continent, but the Noongar are making a play for it, and we have to respect that. In 14th place, we have Pontus. Pontus is one of the stars of the part, but tragically, they achieved nothing in particular. Firstly, Pontus is part of the Anti-Afterid War, where Karmatians have taken all the glory. Woo, go Karms! It's Karmback time! And secondly, Pontus is finally attacking the Kalmyks in the Caucasus. Notably, they've been at war with Kalmyks since Part 2, and only now have decided to act on it. The terrain is rough, to say the very least, but Pontus has a large army, which cannot be said for the Kalmyks, and a sizable portion of that army is besieging Lagan as we speak. Whether it'll be enough to take the city or not depends entirely on Pontus' own willpower. In the meantime, they've sided with Latvia against Makhno in the war on the Pontic Steppe. Though Pontus is unlikely to contribute in a meaningful manner, it makes sense to me that they are participating in the war over a region carrying their name. Oh, and Pontus, of course, is continuing to settle, so they'll be fine even if no success comes from all these proactive wars. All in all, Pontus is making good moves and trying to break out of the Middle East trap. In number 13, we have Thule. Thule continues to rise to record heights for a variety of reasons. First of all, their stats are great, coming in 10th overall on InfoAddict. On a more granular level, they rank 10th in production and 9th in military strength. Second, Thule's only significant neighbor, the Yellow Knives, has dropped the ball so catastrophically that they now have the world's smallest army. And third, 3 Thule settlers have been spotted in northern Canada, preparing to assert dominance over the Arctic coast. I would say everything is coming up Thule this week. In 12th place, we have Latvia. Latvia falls back out of the top 10 after declaring a surprisingly inopportune war against Moknovia. The Moknovist troops are well positioned to deal a fair bit of damage to Latvia before Umanis gets his shit together, and while we're confident that Latvia will ultimately win this fight, declaring the war with such terrible army positioning is worth a few demerits, no matter how you slice it. At number 11, we have the Selkups. The Selkups have solid enough stats and a lot of cities. They've got a decent amount of room to settle more as well. What's unfortunate is that while their stats are decent, they're not good, really. This is kind of tough when civs like Kazakhstan and Dzungars are waiting in the wings and are more than capable of taking advantage of a Selkups that puts its guard down. And breaking into the top 10, we have the Afsharids. The Afsharids take a major tumble down to 10th as they get beaten by the formerly 53rd Civ, a major defeat. And really, last we saw, they weren't really moving their units. Karmas had a lot of units around still, and there was a mountain range in the way. I don't think they're getting those back. Best just keep their new settlers protected next time. In number 9, we have Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan gets out of their war with the Cell Cups unscathed, save some pillaged tiles, and are left as just a perfectly serviceable step civ and not a lot to their name but some decent stats. So it goes. Depending on how the board develops, they may find options for military expansion should they bulk up and get a good coalition against one of their many neighbors. And failing that, they've got the city count to potentially just build an army and outright take on one of those neighbors should said neighbors get boxed in and stumble. Either way, not a bad day for the boys in blue. In 8th place we have Wagi. Well, for starters, Wagi losing the city to Maginda now is not a great look, and it's weird that after losing that city, Wagi gained 3 ranks. However, outside of that, this episode was stellar for Wagi. They defended Korn, stemmed the bleeding, and most importantly, built Gate of the Sun, one of the best wonders in the game. This is the wonder that single-handedly powered Mojave's excellent performance last season. It provides a flat 15% food bonus, which is massive. Stack that with Season 4's powerful island buffs, Wagi's insane UB, and their solid starts, you have an easy recipe for a clear and obvious powerhouse. In 7th place we have Tiwanaku. Tiwanaku are one of the sleeper civs that the rankers are starting to pick up on. They've got a strong, defendable core due to the terrain, and have settled a lot of cities already. It's shaping up for South America to turn into Tiwanaku versus New Holland, but there are a few cities that can make things interesting. In 6th place we have Ndongo. Nzinga continues on the warpath this episode, adding Saba and Kanemboronu to her hit list. Could this amount of warmongering lead to trouble? Will this come back to bite her in the ass? Judging by how weak her neighbors are, I don't think so. In number 5, we have Goguryeo. Goguryeo didn't have a whole lot to write home about this episode. It was a quiet, solid episode of continued build-up. I do want to point out that Goguryeo has settled most of their 9 cities in a straight line, reaching as far into Siberia as they can. I think this is a great strategy, as they're blocking off a lot of territory from Mongolia and Nivk. However, it can bite them in the ass later if they don't properly fill out that territory. It's probably not going to be super easy to defend, but it looks fun on the map. In 4th place we have New Holland. New Holland continues their approach into the jungle, where they're starting to brush up against their neighbors, including an unwarranted forward settle. Despite New Holland's advantage in the rankings in South America, there are multiple other civs on the continent that boast an empire with more than 6 cities. This will be an interesting continent to watch, that is, if the civs can learn to navigate rough terrain. At number 3 we have Pueblo. The Pueblo continue to flail ineffectually at the Osage, but hey, they've got solid stats, a pretty good religion, and have kept active at the settling. They're the current front runner in North America, though that has as much to do with everyone else being a bit weak this run as anything else. They do need to start fighting wars good if they're going to establish themselves on the other side of the mountains and solidify their future. At number 2 we have Shang. Shang had another excellent episode, retaking Old Sarai from Mongolia, making peace with Goguryeo, trading some pot shots with Zhang, and settling several new cities, all without breaking a sweat. With 11 cities, Shang is now the most expansive civ on the cylinder, leading even the formidable pharaohs in this crucial statistic. They're also third in production and second in military. However, they should keep an eye on their science, which is currently below average, because if they can't correct that, there's no way for them to compete with our number 1. Speak of the devil, at number 1 we have the Faroe Islands. Another week, and nothing much has changed for Faroe except they're now settling in North America to exploit combined Crow-Seneca ineptitude. Also, remember that production gap I mentioned last part? Yeah, that just got wider and is now backed by the largest army, the largest tech score, and the largest population, and the second largest crop yield. Combine that with the Faroes essentially having free reign in Quebec due to the aforementioned Crow and Seneca failures, and you got what is the closest to a unanimous first place civ that we have had during this entire cycle. Hell, with an early lead like this, I'm expecting Pharaohs to be, at minimum, in the top 5 for a very long time. And with that, we come to the end of our part. Thank you so much for listening. Come back next week where I say more nonsense in a very, hopefully, chipper attitude. I've been in Yokel. Thank you for listening. See y'all next week.